greetings. If you are Muslim or Christian, I encourage you to listen and learn what the prophets said about God, our Redeemer. This is part two. In part one, we reviewed what the prophets of the Old Testament said of God the Redeemer. Let's see what the New Testament says of God the Redeemer. Luke 1:68. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people. Visited and redeemed. Now, some denominations see Scripture as metaphorical. Something good happens, and it is called a visitation by God's grace. But I think you rob yourself of understanding when you force this view on God. Luke 1:67. Then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through his holy prophets, those of ages past. You see, the prophets revealed that God would visit and redeem his people, as God spoke through his holy prophets. Salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant. The oath he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us deliverance from hostile hands, that we may serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our lives. Remember, this is John the Baptist's father, acting as priest and filled with the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Spirit of Truth. Listen close to what the Holy Spirit is about to pronounce over John. And you, child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways. Malachi 3:1. Behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. Isaiah 43, a voice is calling, prepare the way for the Lord in the wilderness. Make smooth in the desert a highway for our God. And you, child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare his ways. John's father has just identified John as the prophet who will announce the Lord, God, having come to the earth to visit and redeem his people. If you recall, Jesus was already in Mary's womb, growing in the flesh. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people. Did you notice this was past tense? Has visited and has redeemed. The Holy Spirit, who is God, is able to speak of the future as if it were the past already. As far as God was concerned, it was done. Romans 4:17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him who he believed, even God who quickens the dead, and calls those things which be not as though they were. God calls things as though they were, even though they are not yet. Or as they say in Westerns, the Calvary was already coming over the hill.
I think you said that wrong word. Isn't that cavalry? Yeah, cavalry, not Calvary. Texas, you screwed up. You meant cavalry.
Cavalry, Calvary. Cavalry horses, Calvary crosses. I always confuse those words, don't you? I have to think them through each and every time I use one of them, like I just did preparing this video. No, I meant the Calvary was already on the horizon, coming over the hill. The promise of redemption by the cross. It gives me goosebumps even as I say it, thinking of God charging over the hill to the rescue of humanity. But even as prophecies were fulfilled, people did not fully understand the events around them. John 20, verse 8. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For they still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. They did not yet understand the price that had to be paid for redemption. To redeem is to buy back. To buy back requires a payment. Someone had to pay something, to pay for the redemption. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. You know Jesus already knew, right? What are you discussing together as you walk along? One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" That sounds like it could have been delivered with a dolt and a head slap. "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" Don't think God does not know how to play along, all coy, feigning ignorance. Luke 24:19. "Oh, what things?" he, Jesus, asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him." And they crucified him. Certainty. It happened. Ignore any liar who attempts to rewrite events he was not present at. That means anyone 800 miles away, 600 years after the crucifixion happened. "The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel." These two, and many others, hoped Jesus was the one who would redeem Israel. Something Jesus said and the prophets had written suggested the possibility of that reality. Luke 18:31. Then Jesus took the 12 aside and said to them, "Look, we are going up to Jerusalem, and everything the prophets have written about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. He will be handed over to the Gentiles and will be mocked and insulted and spit upon. They will flog him and kill him, and on the third day he will rise again." So Jesus told them in advance he would rise again, meaning from the dead. See, it says, "and kill him." But we trusted that it should have been he which should have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. They had some knowledge, some awareness of some prophecies, but they did not yet have the Comforter who would lead them into all truth. "Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre, And when they found not his body, they came, saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre, and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Imagine this exchange. He said to them, "How foolish are you, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken?" A guy, seemingly oblivious to current events, calls you foolish and slow to believe. He then poses a question ripe with implications. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Remember John 20, verse 9. For they still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. They needed to be taught all the details so they could teach the details to those who followed. John 17, 20. My prayer is not for them alone. This is Jesus praying. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. Once the Holy Spirit came, they were empowered to preach the truth of the gospel. Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. What do witnesses do? They testify to the truth of what they know. John 16:13. However, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak of his own, but he will speak of what he hears, and he will declare to you what is to come. He will glorify me by taking from what is mine and disclosing it to you. To glorify is to give glory to the one glorified. Everything that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said that the Spirit will take from what is mine and disclose it to you. The Holy Spirit led them into the truth, and the following is the truth that they taught. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. Isaiah 53:8, he was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he, the Messiah, was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. Messiah's death was to pay for the sins of God's people. Pay for, buy back, redeem. Galatians 4:3. So also, when we were children, we were enslaved under the basic principles of the world. Our slavery meant we were owned by the basic principles of the world: sin, selfishness. But when the time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive our adoption as sons. In the Old Testament, Moses provided the example. Exodus 24:8. So Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, "Behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord has made with you, in accordance with all these words." The price of the covenant was blood. And in the New Testament, meaning the new covenant God was making with mankind, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Pay for, buy back, redeem. Matthew 26:28. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Pay for, buy back, redeem. Mark 14:24. He said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. The price paid for redemption for our new covenant was the blood of Christ. 1 Peter 1:2. Chosen by the foreknowledge of God the Father, and sanctified by the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ, and sprinkling by His blood. Grace and peace be yours in abundance. 1 Peter 1:18. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life you inherited from your forefathers. Silver and gold are named because redemption has a price, a cost that must be paid. But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without spot or blemish. The precious blood of Christ, more precious than silver and gold, paid for, bought back, redeemed. Romans 3:25. God presented him as an atoning sacrifice through faith in his blood, in order to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had passed over the sins committed beforehand. Titus 2:14, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous for good works. Point 1. He gave himself to redeem us from iniquity, meaning sin. Point 2. He did it to purify us to himself, meaning for himself. 1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Know ye not? Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you? John 14:26. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide or live with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But you know him, for he dwells with you, and shall be in you. Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Paid for, bought back with a price, redeemed. Gotta go a little old school holiness right now. Our body is a holy temple of the holy God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Our holiness, honoring God with our bodies, should be a sign to those around us. Understand the difficulty, however, as you will be judged by ignorant eyes. Those who follow Muhammad will judge you by legalistic rituals they are commanded to follow. Some will judge you for eating bacon. Bacon. But bacon has been redeemed, just as you have been redeemed. Acts 10:13. And there came a voice to him, rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean. And the voice spoke unto him again the second time, what God has cleansed, that call not you common or unclean. This was done thrice, three times, and the vessel was received up again into heaven. God seems to need to use three to get Peter's attention. Jesus said Peter would deny Jesus three times. Jesus asked, "Do you love me?" three times. Eventually, studying redemption in the New Testament, you must grasp and integrate the meaning of purchased. Acts 20:28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. Notice the church of God. God is the antecedent when it says he and his own blood. He, God, paid with his, God's blood. Was God crucified? Did God spill his blood? Seems clear the author wants to convey that. Ephesians 1:13, in whom you also trusted, after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. The Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is the seal, the evidence of your salvation, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, unto the praise of his glory. And in the final book, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation 5:9, and they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book, and to open the seals thereof. For you were slain, and have redeemed us to God by thy blood, out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. Daniel 7:14, and to him, the Son of Man, was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who has redeemed us by his blood. Amen.